death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The darkest day in history. Cross they made for sinners. For every curse is blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake. And the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as the heavens roared?
Come on, lift your voice today. We sing.
All hail King Jesus.
Christmas. Happy Easter. Christ is risen. Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Ramirez Moody, and I serve as the associate pastor of our Young Adults and Compassion Ministries here at Harvest. And I am so glad that you've joined us today to celebrate the resurrection of our King, Lord Jesus Christ. And this is my wife, Kathleen.
Hi, and welcome to Harvest. Happy Easter, everyone. We would love to know where you are watching from today. Let us know in the chat or the comments. If this is your first time with us, I'm so glad you chose Harvest today. No matter where you're watching from, we're grateful that you came. Whether you're new or you come every week, we want to invite you to check in. You can do that on this page through a link in the comments on YouTube or Facebook or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We would love to know you're here. We also want to know how we can pray for you this week. Our staff counts it a great honor to come alongside you and pray with you about the things on your heart.
Yeah. And if you're not a guest, we want to help you worship the Lord through giving. Here are a few ways that you can give. You can give online on this page, or you can also hold your camera on your phone up to the QR code on the screen, and it will take you directly to the giving page at the Harvest website. You can also give through the Harvest app, or through the text, or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. Man, babe, looking back on this last year, so much has changed. If you can remember, last Easter we celebrated completely online from our homes. Many people lost their jobs, and many businesses were closed. And as a church, we found so many people in need of the most basic supplies. We've hosted food drives to help in this time of need. Now at our Rolling Meadows, Elgin, and Crystal Lake campuses, we offer Hope Centers on Saturday mornings from 10 a.m. to noon. If you or someone you know needs food or hygiene items, we invite you to stop by. Details are at harvestnow.info.
Babe, we have a big church with lots of things coming up and very exciting things coming up in the next few weeks.
Yeah.
First of all, if you are a student or you have students in your home, we're inviting all junior high and high school students from all campuses to come to an event we call Second Sunday on April 11th from 5 to 7 p.m. at the Rolling Meadows campus. For all the details, check out harvestnow.info.
Yeah.
And another great event coming up, this one excites me tremendously, is Worship Night.
All right.
We want to invite you to join us this Thursday, April 8th at 7:30 p.m. for our next Worship Night. This takes place in person on our Rolling Meadows campus and will be available online as well.
Yeah. Harvest is a church of small groups. That's where accountability, community, and spiritual growth all take place. If you're not in a group, we want to help you get connected. Find out more at harvestnow.info. Will you join me in prayer? Lord, we just thank you for another opportunity to come together and worship you today. But today is just so special because we get to celebrate the fact that the tomb is empty. And so God, as we continue in praising you, God, I just pray that you will be pleased by what we offer up to you. And God, we just want you in our midst. So will you join us? Will you inhabit our praises today? And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
we continue.
Hey, Harvest, my name is Ramirez, and I'm here with another baptism. I'm being joined today by John Bush. Yeah. So, John, why don't you share with us how life was for you before you surrendered your life to Christ?
Well, before Christ, I never really knew what it, like, meant to follow him, and I never, like, really read my Bible. But recently, God has been moving me to read my Bible and share the good news of Jesus Christ.
All right. That's evidence of the transformation process, right? So tell us, when was it that you surrendered your life to Christ?
About 5 years ago at camp.
Okay. All right. And how has life been for you since then?
God has been really good to me, and he's been showing me how I can further my faith and how I can share the gospel to other people.
All right. All right. I can help you with that. All right. So why would you like to be baptized today?
To let people know that I'm a follower of Jesus Christ.
All right. You ready to do it?
Yeah.
All right. Here, hold on. John, it is by your profession of faith that it is my honor to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Well, let's stand together as we respond. Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed, drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Come on, that's not where the story ends, right?
That's right, that's
come on,
right.
Let's lift our voices, let's sing. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praises. Oh Lord our God. Yeah. And on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar, the cries of the King. Oh, praise the of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night. Then I will rise among the saints with my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Christ is alive. He rose from the dead, and that day, that Easter Sunday morning, that first Easter, when Mary and Mary Magdalene and Salome went to the grave, expecting to anoint a dead body. They saw the angel sitting there, and they said, "Where is Jesus?" The angel said, "He is not here, he is risen." I submit to you tonight that that's the greatest news the world has ever heard. He is not here. He has conquered the grave. He's alive. I don't believe there's a fact in ancient history today so well proven as the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That a man had risen from the dead, that he was alive, that death could not hold him. Christ is alive.
He's alive. He's alive.
Yeah! Wow. Happy Easter, church. You can have a seat. You can have a seat. Happy Easter to all of our campuses who are joining us right now and those who are watching online. Happy Easter to you and your family. Christ is risen. Come on. We have something to celebrate today, don't we? But listen, not just us. Not just us here, but millions of Christians who are gathered together in churches across the world today. What a beautiful picture that is, isn't it? I remember the first time I went to a large conference, and it was in Atlanta, and it was for college-age students and young adults. And when I walked into this arena, there were 50,000 other young adults there, and they were worshiping the Lord in one voice, singular purpose of lifting praise to Him. It was incredible. It was a powerful moment of worship. And today, on Easter Sunday, it's an even greater magnitude than that. Millions of people's voices across the world today united together with a singular purpose, church, to celebrate and rejoice in the risen Savior. It's amazing. And we as a church are uniting our voices across Chicagoland, here in Rolling Meadows, in Elgin, and in Aurora, and in Crystal Lake, and at the North Shore, and at the Chicago Cathedral, and those who are joining us online. We are uniting our voices with those millions, rejoicing in Jesus Christ. And so today, in remembrance, we rejoice. We rejoice. This morning, we're gonna go through the same movements that we went through during Good Friday. And if you didn't join us for Good Friday, or maybe you forgot what those movements were, that's okay, I've got some spark notes for you. Are you ready? In remembrance of Jesus Christ and His sacrifice on the cross, we did a couple of things. We reflected, we repented, we received, and we responded. It was a service of somber remembrance for what Jesus had done on the cross. Now, today is not Good Friday, is it? Today is Easter. It's not about a somber remembrance, it's about a rejoicing celebration. So how on earth are we gonna go through the same movements that we did on Good Friday for Easter? I'm glad you asked. We're gonna look at it through a different lens today. A different lens. We are going to look at it in a lens of victory, not tragedy. You see, the disciples on Good Friday, all they could see was the tragedy. But we here now, we have a different lens, don't we? We have a lens of Sunday. We have the lens of victory. We have the lens of a resurrection. And so we're going to rejoice. We're gonna be in Romans chapter 5. Let's open up our Bibles. Chapter 5, verse 6. Let's read this together. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would dare even to die. But God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by His blood, much more shall we be saved by Him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by His life. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. First thing that we're going to do in rejoicing today is we are going to reflect. We are going to reflect. And we're going to reflect on a couple of things this morning. The first is we're going to reflect on how did we get to the celebration? How did we get to the celebration? You see, Easter isn't Easter without Good Friday. There is no triumph over the grave without the cross. There is no resurrection without the death. And we need Good Friday to have Resurrection Sunday. It's an interesting choice of words, isn't it? Good Friday. Did you ever find that odd? How can something so terrible as the death of Christ be called Good Friday? But through the lens of victory, that the death of Christ led to his resurrection and victory over sin and death. What the enemy meant for evil, God made good. And so we reflect on that, how we got to the celebration. We also reflect on who we are celebrating. If you're new here, and if it wasn't obvious, we're celebrating Jesus this morning. Amen? From viciously killed to victorious king. And this verse in Romans really brings out some characteristics about Jesus that I want us to look at because there is much to rejoice in. Let's look at verse 7 and 8 again. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is true, isn't it? And we don't see this very often. This is rare. This scarcely happens that someone would lay down their life for even a good person, a righteous person. I think that's because we are inherently selfish people who are focused on self-preservation, right? And dying is kind of the opposite of self-preservation, isn't it? And so this is rare, someone laying their life down, even for a good person. But Jesus here takes it a step further. Did you see it? He takes it a step even further. In a transcendent display of love, he laid down his life, not for the righteous or for the good person, but for the sinner, for his enemies. He laid down his life. This is the unmatched, unconditional, sacrificial love of Jesus Christ, and we need to reflect on this. We need to reflect on this love, that God in human flesh, the sinless, perfect Lamb of God, willingly died on a cross for sinners and bore the weight and wrath of all of humanity's sin so that we could have relationship with God. It's the greatest act of love in human history. And we rejoice as we reflect in that amazing love of our Savior who has been raised from the dead, defeating sin and death. We also reflect on our own life. We reflect on our own lives. Look at verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. See it? For while we were still weak, that word weak there means powerless, helpless, without strength. And apart from Christ, that was our reality. That was our condition. There was nothing that we could do to reach God. We didn't have the strength. We can't be good enough to keep his perfect law. We all fall short. It is impossible to keep God's perfect law. We were ungodly. We were sinners, the text tells us. And even still, Christ died for us. And so we reflect on our utter brokenness, not wallowing in pity or in despair, but so that we can feel the full weight of it, so that we can all more realize the wonderful and matchless love of our God. That's why we reflect on what we were saved from, but we also reflect on where we are today. We reflect on what we were saved to. Am I living in the fullness of my new condition in Christ? Or am I living like the old me? We reflect on what we were saved to. You see, Good Friday and Easter are a mirror. They're a mirror for us. And what do we do with mirrors? Well, we all probably used one this morning, didn't we? And we all went into our bathrooms and we looked at the mirror. And what were we looking for in the mirror? Is everything okay? Is everything all right? Is it all in okay, I'm okay, all right, I'm put together. We're looking for blemishes, right? We're looking for things that are out of place so that we can correct them. We're looking to fix some things. Maybe our ties, maybe our hair, maybe something going on in our face. I had to do a lot of work this morning, P.S., if you can't tell. This is new for me. And you all look like you did great this morning too. Well done. Looking sharp for Easter morning, love it. Good Friday and Easter are a mirror, reflecting not our physical appearance, but our spiritual appearance instead. B. because of what Christ has done for us, the death on the cross for our sin, being raised to life, because of that great reality, we can reflect on our spiritual appearance. We can see things that are out of place. We can see things that need to be put back into order, blemishes that need to be fixed. And what we can do with that is we can bring those before the Lord. And we can say, Lord, I see this in me, and this does not line up with who you called me to be in you. Lord, would you help me fix this? Lord, would you fix this blemish in me? This isn't a moment of sadness. This isn't reflecting in sadness. This is actually, we can rejoice in the reflection. Did you know that? We can rejoice in the reflection. We can rejoice because Christ has given us spiritual eyes to see. He has given us spiritual eyes to see. You see, before we were in Christ, we were blind. We could not see our spiritual condition. We couldn't see the flaws and the blemishes. We couldn't see it. But now, because of what Christ has done, because of our faith in him, something has completely changed. Now we can see rightly our spiritual appearance, where we are, what needs fixing, what needs touching up. We have the ability to do that, and that is something that we can rejoice in. We could also rejoice in the fact that he is not done with us yet. Let me say that again for you. He is not done with you. Come on. Isn't it amazing that when we look at the reflection of our spiritual appearance and we're like, oh, I don't really like what I see. There's a lot of work that needs to be done. Isn't it great that Christ is not done with you? He doesn't just get you to a 6 out of 10 and go, okay, go ahead. You're good now. That's a D. D's get degrees. Go forth. No, he's not done with you yet. He's continually helping you. He's working in you. He's working through you. He is not done with you yet. We can rejoice in that. And we can rejoice that he alone is sufficient. He alone. That when we bring our blemishes and our things that are out of place, our sin to him, he is sufficient to heal, to fix, to mend. Him alone. We have much to rejoice in the reflecting. But not only that, let's look at verse 9. Verse 9 says, since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Here's the second thing that we're going to see. The movement of we repent and we receive. We repent and we receive. Verse 9 starts with since therefore. This is a conclusion from verse 6 through 8. Because of the great love of God, through the death of Jesus on the cross, we have now been justified by his blood. And I want to unpack this statement because there is so much for us in this and we have much to rejoice in. Justify simply means this. I'm gonna give us a simple definition. It means to be declared righteous, to be made right with God. We have been declared righteous by his blood, by his finished work on the cross. It is not a righteousness that we possess from ourselves, but a righteousness that has been declared over us by God because of Jesus. It is Jesus' righteousness that has been clothed over us. Why is this important? It's important because it means that when God looks at you, he doesn't see your sinful self. Instead, he sees the righteousness of Jesus. He doesn't see your sinful self. He sees the righteousness of Jesus. This is something called the great exchange. It is great. We have exchanged our sin for something infinitely more valuable. The perfect righteousness of Jesus Christ. You know, a couple of years ago, in an effort to lose some weight and to get fit, I started cycling. Any cyclers in here? hit me up, let's go for a ride. And I found out really quickly that to be a cyclist, you first need a bike, right? And so I went onto some resale apps. OfferUp was the one that I used, and I started browsing around and trying to find a good deal on a used bike. And after a couple of weeks, I saw this amazing bike pop up, and it was dirt cheap. And I'm like, okay. So I texted the guy at 10 o'clock at night, and he responded, and I met him. I don't suggest that, by the way. Don't meet strangers from the internet at past 10 o'clock. That is not a smart thing to do. I don't know what I was thinking. But we met in a very well-lit area, okay? And he pulls out the bike, and I'm like, wow, this is incredible. And I give him the chump change that he requested for it. And I'm like, why are you giving this away? Nah, I don't ride it. I got it from a job. I'm not gonna use it anymore. I'm like, okay, cool, man. So I give him the money. He gives me the bike. I look it over. Nothing's wrong with it. It's in, like, perfect condition. It's carbon fiber. I didn't even know what that meant. But when I lifted it up, I almost threw it over my head. It was so light. And I got home, and I'm like, I wonder how much this is actually worth. So I typed it into my computer. Can I just say it was worth way more than I thought it was? I paid pennies for this bike, and I looked it up. It was an $8,000 bike. I didn't even know bikes could be that expensive. And all of a sudden, I became that guy. I became that guy who got a great deal. I've always wanted to be that guy. I always hear about that guy, like, oh man, you won't believe it. I got this incredible, miraculous deal. And I'm like, I'm finally him. I got this amazing, incredible deal. This is the greatest deal that I have ever got in my entire life. And then I thought about that statement. And I'm like, no, it's actually not. That's a great deal. But I have gotten an infinitely better exchange, an infinitely greater exchange. And it was the moment when I gave Christ my sin, my worthless, disgusting, shameful, regretful sin. And in exchange, he gave me his perfect righteousness. That's the great exchange. That is the greatest deal on the planet Earth. The great exchange. That is the truth of these scriptures here. That we have been justified by his blood. That no matter how far you've gone, no matter what you've done, how bad the things you've done are, the amount of bad things that you have done, no matter how much shame, no matter how much regret, Jesus takes all of that onto himself and gives you his righteousness and declares you as righteous. Someone say amen. That is something to rejoice in this morning. Come on. Then we see two words. We see two words, which are repeated in the next verse as well. Much more. We have now been justified by his blood. Much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. Paul is doing something here in the text. It's called arguing the greater to the lesser. The greater thing in this verse is that we have been justified by his blood. That's the greater thing. That's the more difficult thing. And if Christ can justify us and make this great exchange, then of course he can save us from the wrath of God. Of course he can. It's like saying I can lift 100 pounds. How much more could I lift 50, right? What a wonderful comfort that is to us, that if you've been justified in Jesus Christ, then you can be sure that you're sure that it's sure that you will be saved from God's wrath. Awesome. But we're not done yet. Look at verse 10. It says, for while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Here's another important word, reconciled. It means peace between humanity and God. We go from being enemies to being friends. We go from warring with God to being at peace with him. We go from being far from God to being in his family. This is reconciliation. It is a measure of his grace and the forgiveness of our sins, bringing us together with God in peace. We don't deserve this at all. We were enemies. Heath, come up here for a second. We're enemies right now on Easter Sunday, all right? I'm your enemy. And enemies fight each other, right? So don't punch me. Don't punch me. Just push me. Just give me, okay. Right, this is what we do with God. We try to push him away. This is how we try to live our life, warring against God, trying to push him back, in opposition to him. And all of a sudden, what happens is while we're warring with him, he takes that and goes in for a hug. And he says, we're friends now. More than that, we're family. We're no longer warring against each other. We are at peace with one another. Like, does that even make sense? Does that make sense?
No.
It's crazy, right? Thank you. That's wild. It's wild. This type of love doesn't make sense to us. This type of reconciliation doesn't make sense to us because we don't deserve it. But his love for us is so great that even while we were enemies, he reconciled us to himself. And then we see those two words again, much more. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Again, the more difficult thing here is reconciling us to God. And if Jesus can die for us to be reconciled, then of course he can save us with his life. Meaning we are rescued from eternal separation from God, and instead we are given eternal life with him forever because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Y'all were wondering when we'd get to the resurrection. Listen, we're here now, okay? Here it is. Much more shall we be saved by his life. That's the resurrection. If Jesus' death reconciled us to God, then we can be sure that we're sure that we will have eternal life with him because of his resurrection. This is an assurance of our salvation. We can be sure that we will spend eternity with God because the resurrection secured it. Jesus rose from death to life and ascended into heaven. Listen to me. He is still alive. Still. That's why today is so monumental, because Jesus is alive now. There have been a lot of great people in history. None of them have come back from the dead. They haven't stayed alive. Only Jesus, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the risen Savior of the world. The fact that Jesus is alive is the reason our lives are now in him. And because of that truth, because of the resurrection truth, we have new life in him, now and eternally. And if you have trouble believing that he is alive, can I just tell you? He's alive. I see it now even as I'm looking at the worship center. He is alive here in this moment in our church. He is alive. So what do we do with this amazing truth? We repent and we receive. I think of two categories of people with this: those who have put their faith and trust in Jesus and those who haven't. For those who have put their faith and trust in Jesus, we come to God remembering his vast love for us, that he has reconciled us and justified us through the death of his son. It was our sin that put him on the cross. And in light of his great sacrifice, what he has given to us, and because he is alive, and we don't just believe that, but we experience that, we repent. We say, Lord, if there is any sin in me, forgive me, O Lord. Help me to turn away from that sin for good and receive the grace and the joy that you so abundantly offer to me. Repent and receive. For those who haven't put their faith and trust in the Lord, repentance literally means changing one's mind. To change your mind not only about sin, but also about Jesus Christ as well. Coming to an understanding that you have sinned, you've disobeyed God, you have broken the relationship, and understanding that your sin breaks God's heart. It's understanding as well that Jesus is the only way to restore that relationship, and that faith in him and his finished work on the cross brings salvation.
all that we just talked about, being declared righteous, justification, reconciliation, is offered and can be received by placing your faith in him. Repent and receive. And listen, whatever group you find yourself in this morning, we must respond. We must respond. Look at verse 11. More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Here's the third and final thing this morning. We respond. For those of us who are in Christ, our response is rejoicing in God through our Lord Jesus Christ because of what Christ has done, his death with which he has reconciled us to God, his blood with which he has justified us, and his resurrection with which he has granted us new life. The only response that we can give is one of our highest rejoicing and our highest celebration. Amen? Church, let's not phone this in. Let's not miss the opportunity to rejoice in response. I see people miss the opportunity to rejoice far too often, myself included. In fact, my son Zion, got a picture of him on his birthday. What's happening? I don't know. He's excited though. I'm clapping. Our daughter's just looking at it like, this is crazy, what's happening? He's six. I love him. Can I just say that? I love my son. I love him. But he is terrible at receiving gifts. Can I just say that? Son, if you're watching, I'm sorry. We'll work on it. We did that thing as a family where we all sit around together and we watch him open his gifts, right? Been there? We sit there and we watch, and he would open one, and he would go, oh. And then he would go on to the next one, like, immediately. Then he would open that one, and maybe, like, a less enthusiastic, oh. And then he would go on to the next one, and then the next one, and then the next one, and he would just open it, look at it, put it down. Open it, look at it, put it down. And we had to stop him. We're like, Z, dude, hold on a second. Go say thank you, right? Rejoice in the amazing gift that you have received. And then he went right back to it, and he's like, I got this one, and that's going there, and I got this one, and that's going there, and on to the next, and on to the next, and on to the next, and the next, and the next. And we can often be like the six-year-old at the birthday party, not stopping and rejoicing in the gift. We move past it. We go on to the next thing, and to the next thing, and to the next thing. I'm sure you have a busy week this week. And so we move past the moment of rejoicing to the next thing, to the next thing, to the next thing. Church, that's not gonna be us. We're not gonna do that. We're not gonna move past this like it's nothing of significance. We are going to respond with rejoicing. Are you ready? You have the gift of salvation. Rejoice. You have been given new life. Rejoice. You have been given eternal life. Rejoice. You have been forgiven. Rejoice. You have been reconciled. Rejoice. You have been justified. Rejoice. You have been declared righteous. Rejoice. You have gone from sinner to saint. Rejoice. You have gone from enemy to friend. Rejoice. You have gone from death to life. Rejoice. You are loved by God. Rejoice. Christ has risen. Rejoice. This is the heart attitude that we all must have that bursts forth through us, overflowing from our heart. In remembrance, we rejoice. I'm just gonna ask you to take your seat for one more second. And so maybe you're here today. You've been listening and thinking and pondering about what is being said. Maybe you're feeling something even well up in your heart right now. Maybe you realize that the list that I just went through and us responding and rejoicing, you realize you don't have that. You don't have much to rejoice in. And I don't know who I'm speaking to right now, but maybe you've been living your life for yourself. Maybe you've been doing it on your own. Maybe you've been doing it in your own strength. And time after time after time, you failed. And you feel the overwhelming shame and guilt and regret of that failure. And you realize now that you have been sinning against God. You've been living your life as an enemy to God, in opposition to Him. And that's brought you nowhere. And there's nothing that you can do to change that. It's only brought you despair, helplessness, powerlessness, weakness. Finding that joy cannot be found in how much wealth you have or the stuff that you own or found in another person. Can I tell you something this morning? There is joy overflowing to be found in Jesus Christ. One that isn't dependent on your situation or your circumstances. But there's new life to be had in Jesus Christ. One that can change and transform your life now in a moment. And not only change your life now, but grant you eternal life forever with God. Can I tell you that there is healing to be found in Jesus Christ? That can take your regret, can take your shame, and separate them from you completely. Can I tell you that there is strength to be found in Jesus Christ? Where you can lay your burdens down at His feet and find rest? It's only found in Jesus Christ. Nowhere else. Only Jesus. And so maybe you're here in this moment and you have never made a decision to follow Jesus, to believe in Him, to have faith in Him. Or maybe you thought you have in the past, but you're not really sure. Place your faith in Jesus Christ alone. It's not your parents' faith. It's not a baptism as an infant. It's not a prayer that saves you. It's not a ritual. It's a personal faith in Jesus Christ alone, believing that He lived a perfect life, one that you could never live, believing that He died on the cross, a death that you deserved to die because of your sin, and that God raised Him from the dead and you would be saved. Romans 10 tells us, if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the scripture says, everyone who believes in Him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing His riches on all who call on Him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And today could be your day of salvation. Here, Easter 2021. Call on His name. All who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. Put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of your sin, for salvation, for new life. I'm just gonna ask that everyone here across our campuses, even at home, would you bow your heads, close your eyes? This is a personal decision. It is a personal faith in Jesus Christ alone for the forgiveness of your sin. And if you have yet to do that, if you're not sure if you've ever done that, today, the Lord is calling. He is knocking at the door. Will you answer? If you want to make that step of faith, if you want to declare your faith in Jesus Christ alone, I just want to ask you to do a small gesture of acting out that faith. Just raise your hand right now. No one's looking. Just put your hand in the air. That's me. I'm making that decision. Put it up high. I'm putting my faith and my trust in Jesus alone. I see that. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Keep it up. Praise God. Now I want everyone to lift their eyes. Those of you who raised your hand, listen to me. Christ is enough. He is enough. Let's all respond together by singing that Christ is enough.
Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need.
Praise the Lord.
Listen, you came to him broken. You came to him with sorrow in your heart. And now you go away rejoicing because he is the lifter of your head. This isn't a time to continue to be sad. This is a moment, church, where we celebrate. We rejoice in new life. Listen, if you made that decision, I just want to invite you. We're going to sing one more song because all praise belongs to the Lord. Amen? We're going to sing. And as we sing that song, if you made a decision for Christ, I'd love to invite you to come to the front. We've got pastors and elders who are going to come to the front, and they would love to pray with you. They'd love to give you a Bible. They would love to tell you your next steps on your journey of faith. We'd be so honored to be able to do that. So as we sing this song, if you made that decision, come on forward and we'll meet you at the front. Let's all worship together.
From the grave, from the grave, into the dark, you call my name and brought me back to life again. I rose from the grave. All praise to see the old life is gone and the new has begun.
Too late to respond to the Lord. Text the word follow to 797979. We want to reach out to you and help you get started in your relationship with Jesus Christ. We want to invite you back next Sunday morning at 9 and 11 Central Time. If you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, we would love to see you in person at one of our campuses. And Harvest, remember, Christ is risen, and you are loved.